So I'll be giving a few examples of concurrent data structures, probably only one, depending on how much time I have. But the point is to illustrate the issues that come up in this kind of programming. Okay? But before we go into it, we saw in the morning Professor Kamal's lecture various details about programming concurrency. Okay? I'll touch upon a few other issues. I'll start with a simple example. Okay. Suppose you have 10 processors, let us say. Okay. Your aim is to divide among these 10 processors a particular task. The task is to list out all prime numbers from 1 to 5 million, let's say. So how would you divide the task? If you have just one processor, what would you do? You would go through, you would first check if one is a prime. If it is, you write it in a file, otherwise you don't. Then you would check if two is a prime, and so on and so forth. You would go in sequential order. What if you had 10 processors? Shyamasundar, what would you do?
N modulo 10.
Why so complicated? Why not give 1 to 1 million, I mean whatever, 1 to 500,000 to processor 1, so on.
Because the first few numbers will compute very quickly. And
yeah, so the first few numbers you can check for their primality much quicker than numbers that come later. So you might divide the task up as he says. Okay, give 1 here, 2 here, 3 here, 10 here, and then come back 11 here, and so on. So that's one way of dividing the task. But still, for instance, even numbers you can discard very easily. So you might want to do some pre-processing there. And even after this, there might be some huge numbers which you can easily detect to be composite numbers, right? And some small numbers which might take much more time because they are actually prime. Okay. So your scheme might work, but one can do a further improvement. Okay, which is to say that I'll not fix any distribution at all. Okay, instead what I'll do is I'll have a global counter. It's some number which says what is the next number to be processed. Okay, this stores the next number to be processed. Okay, initially it's 1. Okay, so processor 3 comes up, let's say, it will just pick it up. Okay, I have to process 1, and then it will increment. Okay, so what was earlier 1 will now, the value will be 2 now. So the next processor that comes in will just pick up that value and increment it. Okay, so you maintain a global counter which you keep incrementing, okay, and whichever value that counter has, the processor, that the thread, let's assume that each processor has associated with it one thread, the job of the thread is to repeatedly loop, okay, till do a loop. Inside the loop, what it will do is to go check the value of the count, it will increment it, and it will use the earlier value of the count to check whether that number is prime or not. So this is one scheme that you could follow, okay? But the scheme has a flaw. Yes. That's fine. You needn't necessarily get all the numbers in sequence, but you're pointing out the flaw.
Is that a flaw? Or is it not
a flaw? That is not necessarily a flaw. It's a flaw if you miss out a number, or let's say you process the same number twice. But it's definitely a flaw if you miss out a number. So is it possible that you will miss out a number? Can you see the flaw?
Yeah, when one processor is trying to increment that number and use the previous one, the another process can do the same thing because it's not yet implemented.
Yeah, so the point is that, see, every process, every thread will have code which looks like follow, which looks as follows. You know, while some condition, you check what the value of count is. You do count plus plus basically. Okay, is prime count. Okay.
Font size.
Okay. And if it is prime, you will output it and so on. This is what every, there are 10 threads. Each thread does this. But the point is that this n is a local variable for each thread, but this count is global. Okay, it's sitting somewhere in memory where all threads can access it. And what looks like one instruction to us, namely this count plus plus, is actually many steps in your machine. Right? If you want to increment a value in memory, what happens in a machine? The value is first loaded into the CPU, one is added to it, and then it's stored back to the same location. Okay, so the point is, what happens if, let's say, count, the value of count is, let's say, 2. Okay. And at around the same time, two threads, thread A and thread B, do these operations. Let's say A equals count, A plus plus, count equals A, or count equals A plus 1, let's say. Two threads trying to increment the value of counter at around the same time. What are the possible results at the end of this? What is the expected result, and what are the possible results? What do you expect if two threads increment some variable whose value was initially 2? What is the final value that you would expect? 4, right? Is there anything else that is possible as a result of?
After the first statement,
after the statement, let's say.
Yeah, the context may get switched to thread B.
Okay, so this happens first, and he is saying that this happens next. Okay. So this happens and that happens, and then let's say this happens. Okay, at this value, what is the value of, at this point, what is the value of count?
3.
Okay, the value of count is 3 here. Okay, then this might happen after that. This is the fourth instruction. Okay, at this point, what is the value of count?
3,
because A was equal to 2, right? The value of count here is 3. You expected 4, and what you get is 3. Do you understand this? This is the point, I mean, so in the morning Kamal was explaining all those various ways of programming concurrency using Java. You would have noticed at some point of time that he used some of the methods were declared to be synchronized. Okay? Synchronized is a mechanism of Java which prevents such problems from occurring. Okay? We'll briefly look at how you would solve, you would avoid such problems, okay, or solve such problems. Okay, but is the problem clear firstly? Okay, when two threads act in parallel, yes.
This may not be so bad. Right. Yeah, because you're just checking the number.
Okay. Okay, the bigger problem is to miss this thing. Missing a thing, okay. So let's see if you might actually miss a number. I don't think that will happen in this. Because you are incrementing by 1 always. Yeah, but you might end up repeating a lot of work, which in itself is bad. And it can happen with 3 threads, you mean? Oh, or if there are 3 instructions. Ah, okay.
No, but A is local.
A is local. Yeah. No, but this is still bad because in an extreme case, you might have that count never gets incremented beyond 1. Okay, such an extreme case might happen. Okay, because every time you go, the value of count is still 1 and you try to do something, it never, can it happen? No, that can't happen. It gets incremented by 1 at least every time.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly. So a lot of work gets repeated. Okay, but already that is disastrous enough for us because you don't want to repeat wasteful work. But one can come up with scenarios where things can go awfully wrong. Okay, imagine that thread A and thread B are two accounts, and you want to transfer some money from thread A to thread from the account of A to the account of B. Okay. Depending on how things, let's say you're transferring 50 rupees from here to there, okay, then what would you be doing? Let's write it here. Yeah, no, or you could have a, or you could, these two could be bank accounts and there could be a third thread which is some kind of an audit thread, okay, whose job is to go and sum up the balances in all the accounts, okay. So initially the balance was X, even after a transfer the balance ought to be X, but if the audit is happening alongside a transfer, then you might get various kind of spurious values, okay. So it's an exercise, please think of a simple scenario where there are two accounts, let us say, and there is one audit thread whose job is to from time to time sum up the balances in all the accounts, okay, and if that happens alongside a transfer, then you might get undesirable effects, okay, and that could be much more disastrous than in this case where all we had to suffer was a some duplication of effort. Whereas there, it might have graver consequences. Okay. Okay. So now, the point here is that when threads act in parallel, okay, as what this illustrates is that it needn't all be in one shot. Okay. So this thread executes for a while, context switches. Then the other thread executes for a while, context switches to perhaps a third thread, and then it will eventually come back here. But if they are also, manipulating shared variables while doing this, then you might have, depending on when the context switches, okay, depending on the exact interleaving, you might have undesirable effects. Okay, so that is the point of this example. Now, any programming language which allows you to do concurrent programming has to provide lots of tools for this. Okay, a variety of tools for handling this problem. Okay. One typical solution is to use what are called locks. So how many of you have seen locks before in any kind of programming context?
I mean, the usual scenario is scripting.
I mean,
it doesn't necessarily need a multi-core.
Yeah, it doesn't necessarily need a multi-core. That's fine. This is just in general, multi-programming. Not necessarily multi-core. Spin locks, you said. Okay, so have you actually programmed using spin locks or?
I studied it.
Ah, okay. What other kinds of locks are there?
Semaphores,
mutexes, whatever. Yeah. And then yeah. So spin locks are locks which actually, which actually do a lot of computation. They spin through a tight loop, which is why they are called spin locks. Whereas there are other kinds of locks which have a much bigger infrastructure. If you try to lock and if you cannot obtain a lock, you are made to wait actually. Okay, wait in a queue and so on. Whereas spin locks are locks where if you cannot obtain the lock, you will keep checking whether the lock is available as long as it is available. Okay, as long as it is not available. Okay. So, but for people who have not seen locks, okay, just think of it as some mechanism by which, okay, whenever you encounter a shared variable, like count. Okay, if you have associated a particular lock with this count, okay, then what you can do is you can say a lock, let's say count lock, let's call it. Okay, so let me clean up this code. Let me write the cleaned up code here. So what we had earlier was that each of these threads were executing the following code, right? While some condition still holds, increment the counter, I mean n equals count plus plus, and then you check whether n is a prime. Right? This was the code that we had earlier. Since count is a variable that's shared by shared across all these threads, you would basically say count lock dot lock before executing the statement. And once you are done, you will say count lock dot unlock. Okay, so it's just basically what you would intuitively think of it as. Okay, before you access a shared variable, you sort of lock access to it. Once you have gotten it, no one else can get it. Okay, when you go out, you unlock it. Okay, the point being that if thread A comes, if let's say thread A and thread B are both executing this code, okay, if thread A gets to lock first, then thread B, when it comes to the lock instruction, it will have to wait. The operating system or the programming language, the language environment, the runtime environment of the language, one of these things will ensure that if the lock has been obtained by one thread, the other threads will wait. Is this clear? So lock is some way by which you can lock out. The terminology is meant to be intuitively understandable for, you know, even for someone who has not seen. In fact, if you do a course in concurrent programming, the first few lectures will just be to implement, you know, to look at various algorithms for these locks. Okay, spin locks he mentioned, that's one. Then you can have this notion called monitors, semaphores, monitors. Okay, is there alerts?
Test and increment.
Yeah, test and set is another lock. Okay.
Atomic variables.
Atomic variables.
What variables?
Atomic variables. Yeah. Yes. Atomic variables. They go hand in hand with, you know, test and set, various things. Some of these solutions are provided at the architecture level. Some of these are provided by your programming language, okay, which might be implemented in some sense by, in some way by your operating system. Okay. And in fact, it's when you come to some of these locks that you see the difference between single core and multi-core machines. Okay. For instance, there is a famous lock implementation using what is called test and set. This is an instruction provided by some hardware architectures. Okay, it turns out that if you use the most straightforward version of test and set, the algorithm will perform very badly. The program will perform very badly. Okay, whereas if you use a slightly non-intuitive but slightly more complicated looking version, it will perform better. And the difference in the performance happens only because of multi-core. Okay, because of the way in which the caches, the, you know, the different memories and the various associated with the various processors should synchronize and so on. Okay, so some people asked in the morning, what is the difference between what we are doing here and, you know, multi-core? Okay, there are certain places like this where the difference becomes apparent, but the aim of research is for it not to become apparent. Okay, you want to provide programming tools which will, you know, hide all that complexity in the background. So, I mean, it's a, in fact, we should say it's a failure on the part of the programming language designers that this difference becomes manifest like this. You know, using test and set in the most obvious manner provides a, you know, much worse performance than using it in a slightly less obvious. Okay, but that was just a side remark. Okay, so there are various locks. You can think of lock as just locking and then unlocking. And there are various standard problems that you study in concurrent programming. There are various paradigm problems, right? Kamal mentioned a few in the morning. Barrier synchronization, he mentioned. He also mentioned dining philosophers. Okay, this problem itself is mutual exclusion, the most fundamental of all problems. There is the reader's writer's problem. Okay, there are various problems and solutions using locks and so on. Okay, for almost all those problems, using semaphores or monitors or this kind of locks. Okay, but what we look at today is a slightly to go to the next step. You can think of these things as protecting an individual data item using a lock. Okay, in almost all these solutions, if you want to solve the readers writers problem, then you have a database where people can read from, where people can write into. You treat the database as one whole entity, and you lock access to it whenever someone goes to write it. But you also have to satisfy some other properties, so you might need to use more locks, you know, come up with clever designs to satisfy all your requirements. But the distinguishing feature between what I'm going to do later in this lecture and all those paradigm problems is that here in those problems you use a lock to control access to one single data item. Whereas now what I will talk about is how do you, when you go up to data structures, how do you manage concurrent access? Okay. And the example that I want to use to illustrate some of the issues that arise is a linked list. Okay. So I'll now take this off and we'll move to linked list. Any questions so far? So how one typically uses a lock is clear, right? Even for people who have not seen it before. If you want to access a shared variable, you first, anyone who tries to access it first locks it and then unlocks it. Okay. The first person to get hold of the lock will go ahead. All the other people, they'll have to wait. Okay. You mentioned spin locks. In spin lock, they'll have to wait. While they wait, they'll keep looping. Okay. Whereas there are some other kinds of locks, monitors for instance, where you won't do any active work, but you'll be put to sleep by the system. So that's basically it. Let's move to linked lists. Okay. So we'll keep it very simple. We want to maintain a linked list of integers. Okay. A singly linked list. So there is a head. All the way till you have a tail. There is a head pointer, but there might not necessarily be a tail pointer. Okay, and we'll always assume that head holds the least integer, min, and tail holds the max integer. So even if it's an empty list, you will have min and max in it. Okay, and we'll also assume that we are going to maintain elements in this list in sorted order. Okay, we'll make all these simplifications, and still you will see that there are, I mean, only if we consider a simple enough data structure, we can study issues in concurrency. Okay, otherwise we will be studying data structure and complexity of the algorithms and so on. Okay, fine. So everyone knows, right, how to, so we'll consider three operations. Okay, add is one operation, remove is one operation, and contains is another operation. We'll make a further simplification and say that entries are all unique. So add, if the entry is already found there, it will return a false. Okay. The entry is not found there, it will add the element and then return a true. Remove, if the entry is found, it will remove and return a true. If the entry is not found, it will return a false. Is it clear? Contains, of course, will return true if it is there, return false if it is not there. Okay. Fine. So, yeah. So now the problem is, you can think of many scenarios where this can happen, right? So imagine some game where two players are playing and they have to, you know, some actual computer game where two people are playing, and the people who are playing will be two threads typically, okay? And they'll have to maintain some shared data, let us say, and imagine that that is maintained as a linked list, okay? And you want either of these people to add or remove or check, do this contains query at any point of time. Okay? And it need not just be two, but it could be more than two. So you want to allow concurrent threads to access one shared linked list. Okay? So what would be your first algorithm? it's a, your naivest algorithm or the first cut algorithm is that.
Lock the first element.
Okay, and then lock, so you should tell me. No, I want, in fact, let's follow Kamal's thing and let's define an abstract data type for linked lists. Okay, so you will have, and the first, okay, of course I want to consider, I'll call this coarse list, and you'll know why I'm calling this coarse list in a minute. Okay, and you have to declare some class, public class coarse lists or whatever. Okay, of course it should have a node. Okay, it will have one node at least, head, and head will have a next to it. And node itself contains, node itself is, it has int data, and it has a pointer to next node. This is node, and list will have a head. Okay, what else will it have? Okay, so he said lock the first node when. Okay, so no, you have to give an implementation of all three operations. There is a public add, public boolean add. You have to give code for that. There is a public boolean remove. Mistake in bringing in this kind of representation because I need to mention some Java specific thing when I go into the code, but I will come to that in a minute. So you need to give code for all these three things. Okay, so he said, so the simplest thing you would do is to, like I said, consider the whole linked list as one data item. So you would associate a lock with the whole list. So you will have a lock class, let us say lock equals, okay, so this is a this thing. Okay, and when you, the constructor or whatever, you will basically say this is a new, whatever your favorite lock is. Okay. Like Kamal mentioned in the morning, this lock is an interface. This re-entrant lock is some implementation of that. You could have any kind of implementation of lock. You could have a blocking lock. You could have, you know, various kinds of lock, various kinds of spin lock. Spin locks, okay? But re-entrant lock is, let's say, one lock. So this is an actual concrete lock that you associate with the whole list. Okay, and then what do? If you want to add, you need to basically go through this list to find two positions where this element is smaller, that element is larger. Okay, and you will have to insert the element in this position. Or if one of these things is equal, then you will say, you will return false. Right, but before you do it, you will basically lock, you will basically obtain this lock. So all these, so I'll write code for add here. The first thing add will do is to say lock dot lock. Okay, and then it will find the position. If element is present, return false, else return true, else insert and return true. And then finally you will unlock the lock. This will be the pattern of the code. Okay, and I'm calling it coarse list because it's what you might call coarse grained concurrency. Okay, you are viewing this whole list as one element, you know, which you can lock. So you can become more fine grained. But first let's look at this, and remove will be similar. Okay, to begin with you will obtain the lock, you will do whatever is needed to be done, and at the end you will unlock the thing. Okay, contains doesn't need to do any but let's just make contains also lock and unlock. Okay. Yeah, because while contains is happening, someone else might come and you know, remove the position, remove something. But it so turns out that I'll if I have time, I'll discuss that. It so turns out that you don't need to do anything with contains. Contains can just, without locking, do search for the position of the element and return true or false. Okay, you don't want queries like contains to lock and unlock, because in a typical data structure, okay, you will, these kind of queries will be much more than the operations that modify the data structure. Okay, so you would want to keep these kind of queries as efficient as possible. Okay. Yeah. You are locking that one. No, this, there is one. There is one. See, lock is a class. Okay, some implementation. So it is associated with this list. Okay. So every time any thread tries to do any operation on the list, it will first lock it. Okay. It will first lock this lock. Which means what? If thread A first gets the lock, if thread B comes and tries the same lock operation, it will have to wait. Okay. Fine. So no two operations can happen on the list at the same time.
Yeah.
Who's leaving?
You lock the whole train.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, this is the point. So, so let's try to look at the, okay, what is, there is one advantage to this code, which is that it's easy to prove correct. And you might ask, what is there to prove correct in a linked list algorithm? You'll see in a minute. Okay, when we go to more involved solutions. Okay. Yeah, one virtue of it is that it is easily shown to be correct. But, and that shouldn't be discounted, of course. Okay, because, and there are situations where this might be fine. Okay, let's say you want to provide access to some shared data structure to various people, but you know that it is very rare that two people at around the same time try to access it. Then you don't need to break your head trying to get a very involved algorithm. You just do this. If you can somehow, if your program is such that concurrent accesses are rare, then it's fine. Okay, but concurrent accesses are not rare. Okay, so there are situations where there could be a lot of concurrent accesses, in which case this is bad, and it's especially bad because if I try to add something here, and let's say Venkatesh tries to remove something here, okay, I mean, there is no reason why these two things should lock each other out, right? Because whatever pointer manipulations I do here, it is not going to affect what he is doing. Whatever he does is not going to affect what I am doing. So you want to avoid this kind of a scenario where, you know, operations happening at some two far away locations in the data structure lock each other out. Okay, so therefore you might want to go to something called a fine list, which is a fine grained list. Okay, and what is the finer grain of control here? Instead of the list, at the node level. Okay, thankfully I have this still. So each node, now each node has a lock associated. And not the list. This can be a re-entrant lock or whatever. This is not syntactically correct Java code or something. I'm just giving you some sense of what is happening. Okay. So each node has a lock associated with it, and what you do is you lock nodes as you go along. Fine. So how would code for add look now? You need to get a little more precise here. So you have to have a predecessor pointer which will point to head. Okay, you are going to add some x data set. Okay, head. Current pointer which will be head.next. And what are you looking at? You want to look at whether predecessor dot value is less than x and current dot value is greater than x. Okay. So basically what you want to do is you want to do a loop where while current dot data, whatever you call it, you keep advancing these two pointers. Okay. Okay. Once you come out of the loop, you want to check if it's equal to x, then you have to do something. Then you return false. Else, what do you do? Create a new node. New node with value x, and you will basically say print.next. Will be the code, but what if two people try to do the same thing at around the same time? Then there will be conflicts, right? I'm not locking it at the list level, so I have to lock it at the node level. Okay, and in locking it at the node level, now various choices have to be made. Okay, you could just lock one of these two nodes, or you could lock both these nodes. Okay, so exactly. So you just need to lock the predecessor always, because finally what you are going to change is, suppose the node is going to, x is going to go between pred and cur, then what is going to be changed is the next pointer of pred. So it's enough to lock pred. Yeah. So, but no. You can't do that, because as you are proceeding, as you are doing this thing, that's this thing. As you're doing this thing, remove might come and remove some. Okay, so you do, one thread is trying to add, another thread is trying to remove, and you might actually go out of the, you might actually end up, yeah. So this problem might, it's not enough to lock only outside of the loop, because look at this example. Okay, you're trying to let's try some example. Yeah, right. You are trying to add some x, let us say. Okay, you are going along this path. Okay, let's say you are trying to add 50. Okay, as you are going along this thing, let's say the data values here are 20, 25, 30. Let's say. Okay, at this point, okay, so after this, in the original list was 35. Okay, after this was 60, let us say. Okay, you are proceeding along this line. Okay, and what happens is that, just at the point where you have to go from here to there, okay, another thread might remove 35. Okay, in which case, what will happen is that, there will be this edge will be broken, okay, and that edge will be added, but this edge will still be there. Okay, and what you have done is, as part of your code, you have pred and you have cur dot next and all that is there. You have determined that something is just a second. Yeah, basically you will insert this thing between, yeah, I'm trying to figure out. Yeah, you will end up inserting 50 between 35 and 60, and it's outside of the loop, basically. And this might happen because just you might have determined what cur dot next is. Okay? Because remember, this operation, we should go back to this thing. At a level of a machine, this operation is not one atomic operation. You have to read cur dot next into the CPU, then you have to assign it to something and then write it back to cur. Okay? You have read cur dot next to be this. Okay, the next time you get control, you have assigned it to cur, so you have actually moved here even though you ought to move there. Okay, and you have now inserted it here. So you need to lock every node as you go along. okay, and not just that, okay, here at least, okay, you need to lock at least one node, you know, each thread which you are going to modify, you need to keep locking it. Let's look at the code for remove. Remove should act similarly, right? It should search for the position, and once it comes here, what it will do is, instead of doing this, it will say if cur.data is greater than x, then it will return false. If it's equal to x, then it will set pred.next to cur.next. Okay. So for remove, the code here till now will be similar, but here it should say if cur.data is greater than x, return false. Return false. Else, pred.next equals cur.next. Return true. Oh yeah, the Java specific thing I said was that, see, this pred, cur and so on are names that you use inside the definition of this list. Okay, but when I am trying to explain these things, I am trying to make it sound as if the spread, cur and so on are variables that are local to a thread. Yeah, so this you can manage that thing by using something called thread local variables in Java. Okay, Java allows you to do it. There are other languages also that allow you to do it. Okay, the point is that, see, you have to consider all these things when you write concurrent programs. You want to describe objects, okay, concurrent objects, you know, which allow concurrent threads to access them, and you want to have a uniform description of these objects, okay, but you want certain things to remain local. The spread, cur and so on should remain local to each thread. Okay, so this is the Java specific thing I wanted to say, but it's allowed in other languages too. Anyway, this is the code for remove.
But in this case, they could be simply local variables to add.
No. But the point is that each time a thread tries to access it, okay, it should be.
If they are local to the procedure itself, okay, then they will be already.
Yeah, that's true. There is a need for thread lock. Yeah, that's true. But sometimes, okay, pred and cur is fine. But sometimes you need so thread local variables. What they do is, they'll not be recreated every time the same thread. See, if they are just local variables, then they'll be recreated every time the function is called.
Yeah.
But thread local variables, they'll be created once for each thread identity. Okay, so I mean it's some this thing, but so if you don't get it, ignore the last minute
like,
comments.
Like static within the thread.
Yeah, exactly. It's static within the thread. So is it clear what is happening in add and remove? But except I have not put any locks here. I have already told you that you need to lock pred, because add along with the remove will create problems. Now, remove itself requires you to not lock just one node but two nodes. Okay, we will see how. Okay. So the point is that you need to lock both pred and cur every time. Okay. And then when you move, you need to lock the next thing and then unlock this. So this is called handover hand locking. So you always have two nodes locked at any point of time, sometimes three, okay, at intermediate stages. Okay, so the reason for two locks is this. This is a look at the thing. I don't think I need to. Let's see. So this is head, and it points to A, which points to B, which points to C. So can someone think of a problem that will happen when you lock only pred? Because pred is the one that needs to be locked, right? If anything has to be locked, because pred is being modified. Okay, you are modifying pred.next to make it equal to cur.next. Right? You're modifying the data itself. Okay. So you need to lock pred. So initially, okay, let's say there are two threads, one of which is trying to remove A, the other is trying to remove B. Okay? Let's see what might happen. And everyone locks pred alone. So each code tries to lock pred alone. Make pred.next equal to cur.next. Right? So you will make this point to C. B is not removed at all. Okay, is it clear? Let me go over it again. This was the original list. Oh, I'll use some colored chalks. They look good at all. Hopefully one can distinguish these two colors. Let's see on the board. So there is A, thread A, okay, which tries to remove A. Thread B tries to remove B. Okay, thread A goes through the list, and it is at the point where cur is equal to A and print is equal to head. Okay, so head is being locked, so you put a lock here. So there is a lock here. Okay, now thread B goes ahead and locks this. Okay. Thread B searches all the way to B, where cur is equal to B and print is equal to A. So thread B locks this. Yeah. So now thread A goes ahead and removes node A. How does it do it? It says, so this is thread A, so let me print sub A and cur sub A. Okay. This is also a spread sub B. Is it clear? Okay. So at this point it says, oh, spread A dot next should be equal to car A dot next. So this guy deletes this and redirects this all the way there. Okay. What will this guy do next? You say, oh, spread B dot next is equal to car B dot next. So I'll do this. This guy will modify this and put it all the way, wrong color. Okay, so, but on the other hand, if both pred and cur are locked at all the time, then what will happen? This will be locked, that will be locked. Okay, and if for thread A, both these things will be locked. For thread B, both these things should be locked before any action happens at all. But two threads can't lock this node at the same time. Okay? According to the very definition of locks. I mean, according to the... Yeah? So therefore, you will avoid this problem by locking both thread and cur at the same time. Okay? So this is one illustration of a problem that could occur. So typically in this code, what you will need to do is to lock both thread and cur. Okay, and then once you advance the pointer, you need to lock the new thing and then unlock the earlier thing. Okay, so I will not write the explicit code here. At the end, I will give the reference to the book which will contain all this code. I am sure the code is common enough to be found elsewhere on the internet too, but I will give it at the end. Okay. Is the algorithm clear? So as you go along this list, you have two pointers, spread and cur, pointing to two nodes. You lock both of them. Before you advance, you lock the new node, unlock the earlier one, and you keep going like this. Okay, fine. So one more thing you might ask is, you know, should I first lock spread and then cur, or should I first lock cur and then spread?
First lock spread and cur.
Whichever is fine, but you need to both these processes to follow a uniform policy. Because if you said add will first lock pred and then cur, and if you said remove will first lock cur and then pred, then there might be deadlock. Okay? Because you might be at a point where this guy has locked, A has locked this and is waiting to lock that. Okay? Whereas B has locked this and is waiting to lock this. You don't want such deadlocks to happen. Okay? So you see how things, so typically you will encounter deadlocks in a concurrency programming course when you deal with algorithms for mutual exclusion or some such things, but those are involved algorithms and it will always look a little contrived, you know, because these might not occur in real life, you might think. But here is a real life scenario where you will immediately get into deadlocks if you didn't program it right. Okay.
So other algorithms like to lock multiple things, but if one of them fails, then unlock everything and keep trying.
Yeah, you could do. Yes, you could do that. Yes. Yeah, you could do that. Fine. So how will contains work again? So contains needn't lock anything actually. Contains could just, because it's only saying true or false. Okay. It can just go through the list, and but there might be problems. It, yeah, so here is the point to discuss when I should discuss that. Suppose your contains was a very simple routine which just started from beginning to end till it found the element. Okay, if it is there, it will say yes. If it's not, it will say no. What might happen is that as your so this is your list. As your contains proceeds through this list, okay. Remember, contains is not doing any locking. So if you have to wait for each other and so on, then you need to also lock. That is the fundamental thing. So one thread says node dot lock, okay. Another thread also has to say node dot lock for it to wait. If it doesn't do anything, then it can just go ahead. Okay. So this contains the code that disregards all lock and goes ahead. Okay. As it goes ahead, let us say it is at this point. Okay. And it has to next do curr equals curr dot next. Okay. It has determined that curr dot next is this node here. Okay. So it will have to do that assignment. But before it does this assignment, okay, after it has determined curr dot next and before it assigns it to curr, somebody comes and removes it.
That's not a problem.
Yeah, that's what I want to illustrate. So somebody comes and removes it. Okay, so what would the contains routine do? So this is x, let us say, and you want to do contains of x. You want to say whether x is contained in the list or not. So you went ahead, and just before you went and saw this thing, okay, somebody came and removed this x. But what would you do? What would this contains routine do? This thread will just go there, see x, and say, oh, x is present in the list. You know, question is it correct or not? Yeah, this is an important thing. See, the point is, when we pointed out flaws, it was obvious what the flaws were. But when you want to say that something is correct, you want to know, you know, you want to have a much more refined notion of correctness now than you had for sequential computation. The point is that this contains routine happens in time. It starts at some point of time and it goes on for a while. And the remove routine also happens for a while. Okay? When these two things happen, when these two things overlap in time, okay, it is okay to say, I mean, when you view the final results, okay, it could either be the case, you might either observe that happened first and then this after that, or that this happened first and then that. Okay. So things that overlap in time, you can order them in any way you want, but there are certain consistency conditions that you need to follow when you say that you can order them in any way that you want. Okay, so there is one notion called linearizability. Unfortunately, I don't have time to go into that, and it's a technical notion, so it's a little difficult to motivate also. There is another notion called sequential consistency. Okay, you need to follow some of these. So these are the usual notions of correctness that you follow. Okay, because even the notion of correctness is subtle here, because things overlap in time, okay, and either order could be thought of as admissible. Okay, fine. So contains works this way. Now I'll have to okay, this is a reasonable enough improvement, because if things happen, if something happens at the end of the list and then something, and after that something happens at the beginning of the list, they don't need to overlap. But still there is a problem, right? if one thread wants to access the second element in the list, and another thread wants to access the 10th element in the list. Okay, A wants to access the second element, B wants to access the 10th element. Okay, clearly B has to follow A. If A goes first, then B will have to follow A. Yeah, so A will first lock this and then lock that. B will have to wait for A to release those locks before it can proceed. Okay, so this is again not a very desirable situation. Okay. So one goes for refinements of this. Okay, there is a refinement of this called optimistic linked lists, where when you search for the element, you don't do any locks at all. You go all the way without locking. But once you have found the element, this is when you want to do the pointer manipulation. then you lock the elements. Okay, but then because everybody is proceeding without locking, you need to check whether things are correct. So you need to go back to the head of the list and come all the way down to see if both pred, if pred is accessible and if pred.next is actually equal to current. Okay, you don't, you need to do both these checks. Okay, so I mean, so this is like some, a tourist goes to a new country and takes a cab ride. The cab driver jumps all the red lights, and every time this tourist is scared to death, he's asking what he is doing. The driver says, "Don't worry, I'm an expert." Fine, but suddenly at a green light, the driver stops. This guy asks, "What happened?" "Yeah, yeah, but there are other experts too, so I have to be careful now." So this is the point. As long as there are, as long as you have not found your element, you just keep going ahead disregarding locks. But when you have found your element, you don't immediately do the modification, but you lock the things and go back and check. But this introduces one new thing. Firstly, you know, it's not one traversal but two traversals. You do this traversal once and then you go back and check whether the, you lock these two elements alone, and then you go back and check whether they are proper. But what if they are not proper? This is the question. So you went ahead and found your element, you have a pred and cur, you have locked them. You want to check whether nobody else has modified it. You know, between the time I determined that this was the point and when I locked it. Fine. If you go and do this validation routine and if it is found to be not valid, then you repeat the whole process all over again. Okay. So, but the point is, I mean, so in an extreme case, it might lead to starvation. You might keep, you know, going back to the head of the list all the time. But in practice, it might, I mean, such a thing will be very rare. And you are anyway saving on the cost of locking each and every node as you go. Okay. You are doing only, you are locking only two things. Okay. And, okay, so this is, this has to be justified only by your, by empirical tests and on what kind of operations, you know, you are linked to, I mean, what kind of manipulations happen on your links. Okay, so it depends on your program. Okay. But in practice, it might be fine. And starvation is very rare, usually, practice. Even though it's theoretically possible. Okay. So this is, you might do this refinement of not locking at every step, but locking only after you have found it and doing the validation. The next step you might go for is to say that, okay, why do I need to do this? I mean, the validation routine that we had, had to go back to the head of the list and search all the way. Instead, you might say, okay, you might simplify the validation routine a little bit. If you did two things, you know, associate with each node a mark, which says whether, a logical mark, which says whether it is in the list or not. Okay, and the remove routine first marks it as outside the list and then physically removes the link. Okay, so now validations routine might be, will be much easier. Okay, because all you need to check is whether the node is marked or not. Okay, you don't need to go back to the head of the list and check and so on. You are here, once you have found the two nodes, you just check whether neither node is marked and if the pred.next is equal to current. Okay, that's all you need. And again, the correctness of all these things, you will have to go back to this. If things overlap in time, then either result is fine. Okay, if a remove happens alongside a contains, it could say yes, could say no. Okay, but it should be logically consistent according to, you know, some, there are some minimal logical constraints that you will put. Okay, in fact, almost all these data structures are what are called linearizable, okay, which is a very strong condition that you can. Okay, so I think I should stop with this, but I will mention just one more data structure. Okay, so linked list is something where operations naturally happen at various ends. So you would think that a linked list is a data structure that is naturally parallelizable. You can grant concurrent access. Okay, naturally. There are some other data structures where it doesn't seem so obvious. Let's consider a stack. Okay, every element that has to, I mean, you want a shared stack to be shared by many concurrent process, concurrent threads. Everybody has to modify the top of the stack. So there has to be a lock. I mean, whether you consider it as a fine grained lock or a coarse grained lock, you have to lock the top. So where is the concurrency here? It looks like it's almost sequential. Okay, people have found clever solutions for this. Okay, one solution is to say, go check the top of the stack. If it is locked, then don't try immediately again. So this you might have seen even in spin locks and so on. You do what is called exponential back off. Okay, first time you find that it's locked, you back off and come back after a random amount of time between 0 and 2 seconds, let us say. Okay, seconds is too large, let's say 0 and 2 time units. And then if you again find it locked, you back off and then you come back at a random time between 0 and 4 time units and so on. So this is called exponential back off till some point. Okay, you can do exponential back off and hope that, you know, the randomness will take care of the fact that, you know, when you come there it is not locked. But you can do even better. Okay, you can, this clearly utilizes the fact that utilizes the nature of stack operations. If somebody does a push and somebody else does a pop, then it needn't necessarily, you needn't necessarily do it, right? You can eliminate the, you can cancel the two operations. So when you back off, okay, you don't come back to the stack, okay, you go to an auxiliary array where the various threads, okay, so you pick a random index in this array, okay, and swap whatever value it has with whatever value you have. Suppose you want to push, okay, you enter push here, okay, and then you take whatever value is there. So there might be some initial, there might be some value which says only one element till now, okay, in which case you have to wait for some other element to arrive here. Okay, if you wait for a while and no other element arrives here, you will just delete your entry here and go to the stack again. Okay, but some other entry might, some other thread might choose the same random index, and what might happen is that thread will swap its value with this. Okay, if this was a push and that was a pop, then the two will cancel each other out and not even go to the stack. If both are pops, then it's fine, that's a pop, this is a pop, nothing happens, you go back to the stack again. If both are pushes, that's also fine. This was a push X, that was a push Y. Both will go, I mean, you started out with a push X, you went to this array and tried to do some exchange. You exchanged it for a push Y. So you go back to the stack. Okay. But the nice thing is that if a push and pop meet in this array, then they'll cancel each other out. Okay. So this is one way by which, you know, you look at data structures which don't even seem like they have scope for concurrent access, and you can do it. Okay. And access to this array is concurrent. Okay. I mean, array is, after all, you're just picking a random index in the array and you're just trying to lose. And there are no locks or anything in this array. Okay. So this is just to tell you that, you know, you can do lots of fancy stuff with, you know, starting from simple things. Okay. So I think I'll end here. If there are any questions, you can.
Suppose there are two operations who are trying to push a value to the stack. The order in which they appear in the stack finally is not unique.
Yeah, that is fine. You don't want, yeah, you just want the pushes to happen. You do not want the order to happen in the exact time. I mean, yeah, this is all concurrent. This goes back to the notion of correctness that we talked about when a remove and a contains overlaps, right? When two pushes overlap, what do you want the result of the final stack to be? It could either be this or that, okay? Unlike in sequential algorithms where you want an exact order, here there is no such thing. Anything else? So I hope the basic list algorithms and the issues that arise here at least were clear. Okay. Yeah. Ah, yes. So there is this excellent book by Maurice Herlihy and Nir Shalit. It's called Art of Multiprocessor Programming. Whatever I presented was from chapter 9 of that book. Okay, but the book is, I mean, if you want to understand concurrency issues that arise in multi-core architectures, this is the book too. I mean, this is one of the best references out there. Okay, these two, I mean, the two authors
are Gödel Prize winners, in fact, for related work. Thanks.